I'm Thea Hilhorst of the International Institute of Social Studies of Erasmus University, and this is lecture 4 of my series on how to design and do your research. This lecture is about case studies. What is it? Why do we do them? And what can we learn from them? Let's get started. First, I need to give you praise for the case study, because case studies have sometimes been seen as a very second-rate type of research. A case study is a research method that involves an up-close, in-depth and detailed examination of a particular case in its context. Now, if you read conventional methodology books, they may say some very derogatory things about case studies. So, there's no broader reliability, or they're really only useful preliminary research, but then you need to bring in the real deal and do some big and large research. No, says Vliegberg, the guy who wrote a really influential article about case studies. No, he says, case studies have much more merit and are really, really important. Case studies are useful for many purposes and can be used in all the stages of research. No matter where you are, a whole research can be made out of case studies and be valuable. One reason why it is so great to have a case study is because of its proximity to reality and a very close notion of how the research comes about, which you report on, gives you a very advanced understanding, because you cannot understand stuff outside of its context. So because you're so close to that reality, you can understand things not just as a set of properties or variables, but how they work together and how they work out in their context. It's real life. And the value of that type of knowledge is very big. So concrete, context-dependent knowledge is valuable. And, says Vliegberg, we would probably learn more from a series of case studies than from one attempt at a predictive theory that is universal, because all too often, perhaps always, those predictive universal theories don't fly in the end, and we find out they are not really valid. So then we better have a series of context-specific case studies, real life, that we can learn from. And case studies can actually be very relevant for policy and valorization purposes, research uptake. Why? Because politicians, just like other people, learn from examples. Just think of yourself, the lectures you got about really big theories that were so predictive. Were they sticking to your mind? Or was it sticking to your mind the examples that the lecturer gave to illustrate the theory? Well, people are different. Some people might have that head for real abstract theory, but most people, believe me, they learn from the examples that were given, the stories that were told when somebody was explaining the theory for you. So it is really stories, cases, narratives where we learn from. It's examples that we learn from. Very often we don't learn from the theory, in general terms. Now, what is a case? And I approach that question here by asking you, what is the scope of your case? Is it clear, when you choose to do a case study, what the case is? Now, I have two reasons to pose that question in this way. One is that I find that very often, when we do a case study, what we're actually doing is a case in a case in a case. So the case study gets different levels. At first, you say, I want to do a case of a certain phenomena within a certain country. So it seems to be that your case is your phenomena in that country. However, within the country, you very often find yourself, what am I going to look at? Where am I going to really do my study? It could be in one province, in one community, or it could be in multiple communities. And then these are all your cases again. These are also cases. I will go back to that question of the multiple communities next, but just bear with me now that I'm talking about different levels. And then within that community, you cannot talk to everybody. So you select your participants. And you might say that every individual participant is again a case. So you will end up saying this research is built on 20 cases, meaning 20 stories, 20 households, 20 people that I've interviewed and whose stories build up to make my case study. So when we talk about this is my case, we usually talk about different levels, and we better be clear what we mean at a certain moment. Are we talking about the bigger case, the case of the community, or the case of the people we interview? Now, another complication to define the scope of the case, that sometimes a case is not like a bigger, smaller, specific case level, but it could also be that cases are composite and that they exist and that they are being studied at multiple sites. There's a very famous article by Marcus, 1995, that talks about multi-site ethnography. So what it means is we're interested in a particular change. That would be our case, or that would be our research interest, sorry. And that interest, that change plays out, is produced multiply in multiple sites. And then, if you want to study that case, you cannot go to one single community, but you have to actually go to multiple sites. And together they form your case. So multi-site ethnography is usually done by following something. You follow something through multiple sites. Now the something could be the money, follow the money, or a group of actors that travels the world. If you are interested in refugee journeys, you would follow some refugees, how they go from one place to the next and how they move onwards. The spread of an idea, you could have an interest in how does a certain type of populism come about, and then you have to see in different places where it is played out and produced. Or a certain policy, where is it coming out, where does it, how does it travel, how does it get translated on the way. So a multi-site ethnography is happening at multiple places where the change you're interested in gets produced. I once did a research like that together with a PhD candidate. We were interested in climate change adaptation in Mozambique. And to be able to know how people talk about climate change adaptation, we asked people in communities. My PhD researcher, he went to churches to listen to the sermons of the priest on how they interpret climate change and what they have to say about it. He went to ministries, different types of ministries, to find out how the policies came about and how they compete over policies. And in all these different sites, we were able to make a composite picture of how climate change adaptation in Mozambique is talked about. Now, going back to that question, if you have a case in a particular country around a particular phenomenon, very often people think it is better to do it in multiple communities. So within that case, they identify two or three sites where they want to do the research. Or sometimes it is a particular question at a global level, which is being studied in two or three countries. So there are multiple cases in that one bigger case. Now, why is this? We call it a small N research. So there are few cases. It's not like your 500 cases that you can only analyze statistically. It's not your single case, but there is a small n, 2, 3, 6, up to 9 maybe. Now, small n research has an advantage over large n because you can still analyze your cases in the context, and bring in the context as a very important setting where the thing that you're interested in plays out. Small N research also has advantages over a single N research because you have more breadth. However, you also have less depth because you only have so many means and times and hours and days to do your research. So if you spread your attention over three cases, you don't have the same depth as if you would focus all your attention on one case. Now, another reason why small N cases is often considered is that it can make the research more convincing. because we are concerned that if we do the research with an objective to change, for example, a particular policy, that policymakers will not buy it if we say these are our conclusions based on a single case. So that could also be a reason to say, well, very pragmatically, I think I have to take multiple cases. Now, what is not a good reason to do multiple cases is because you see that everybody else is doing it. So you sort of take it as the default way of doing research. That it is not. You have to have a good reason to choose or not to choose to work through multiple cases. So these are some questions you ask yourself before you decide on the multiple case. Does answering my research question require multiple cases, or would this question be better answered with a single case study? What is the added value of the second or the third case? What is the rationale? Why these cases? Sometimes people just say, I did it in three communities, but why three? And why these three? Why not other communities? Why three? Why not one? Why not ten? And why these three communities? And in relation to the point I just made, ask yourself explicitly, who do I want to convince? Who do I want this research to speak to? And what will it take it for them to be convinced? And then I can adjust my research strategy accordingly. Always think about the choice. Don't just do it because other people do it. Be transparent and justify your choices. Why these? Why so many? Now, how you select your case, that's the next question. What is, again, a question that should follow from the purpose of your research? What are your research questions? From there, what would you want the case to do for you? What should the case give you? What should it provide? And then you can choose to take what we call an outlier case. Very extreme case, defiant, to understand the exceptions, magnify the factors and the processes. We see that now with people all looking at the small island states when they talk about climate change. It's a very exceptional case, but it is also because we think this is a very important case that we can learn a lot from because there's so much pressure on these islands. You can choose if you have multiple cases, you can go for You can go for a typical case, so a case that is average on crucial factors. So it's different from the extreme case. No, you choose it because it is typical. I want to do a study in a city. I don't want to go to a mega city. I don't want to go to a very small city. I go to an intermediate city, not too big, not too small. And perhaps there are some other variables that you find important where you seek out some median or average, and that is your case. Then, in the case of multiple cases, you can go for maximum variation. So here you think about the significance of context factors. So you choose cases across a number of contexts where you feel that those factors are different. And therefore, the context may have different, will play out differently for the thing that you're interested in. Another reason to choose a case is what I now call, for lack of a better term, local knowledge. And it sounds perhaps not very valid for your case study, but it is. It can be very valid that you say, I'm going to do the case in this place because I know the mayor of that city is actually very interested and would like to see the findings and would like to know how it works. That woman or that man is such a devoted, committed policy person that I really would like to work there, so I'm sure my findings will be used. Or you say, I already have privileged access there. I know that area. I know those people. I grew up there. And for my research question, that is very important because I will not get the depth of data that I could get if I was a stranger to the place. Again, if your research questions are such a way that it would be good to have such local knowledge because it's a difficult research, so you need privileged access, then that is a very, very valid reason to choose that case. It could be a key case, which has a very special interest for testing a policy. A policy that, when they talk about a policy, they also take that same example. They always say, oh, this policy will really be good because in that place something happens. Go to that place, because then you speak about that particular place, which is so seen as very crucial for that policy. Or it could be a paradigmatic case, a case that stands for something much, much bigger than the case. We could go back to the small island stage here, because one reason why people choose to focus on the small island stage is because they're extreme. So we can see what happens under those extreme conditions. But people also go to the small island stage because they stand for something much bigger. That is where we see climate change already playing out at a level and an extent that many people expect it to have in the world at large. So the small island stage are for some people like the case that stands for climate change as it will hit the planet as a whole. So that could be called a paradigmatic case, that one case that tells you something about a much bigger whole. Now, your strategies for choosing a case will be different at different levels. So for example, the case you choose for a particular reason, because of importance, for being typical, for being an outlier. I just wrote there that this study on disasters is done in Mozambique, because that is one of the top five disaster-prone countries. Within the case, you choose multiple sites, multiple cases, perhaps or not. Why do you do it? To compare, because they are extreme, they are varied. We choose two research sites, one where the program was successful, the other one where it was not. And your research participants, the third level, you choose again for a particular reason, to maximize variability, stratification, random. In the community, we interviewed men and women in different employment categories. Now, why am I saying this? Because if you look at the justification of the research, what we see is often a researcher will justify one level. Why am I doing this research in Mozambique? But forgets to explain the other levels. Why those areas? Why not more? Why not less? And why those? Why those research participants? Why not more? Why not less? And why them? So all these different level choices must be made consistently and transparently. Now, a case is a construct. My next topic here. And that is, it's actually a bit different, it goes a bit deeper, and it asks you the question like, what is a case? Is a case an empirical thing? Is it just waiting out there to be analyzed? Is the case the disaster that is happening in Mozambique? Or is there the research question, the theoretical angle, and other factors that co-construct the case and co-determine what something is a case of? Very often, I can look at the same phenomenon in the same place, but because I have a different research question or a different research angle, a different theoretical starting point, that same something can be the case of this or that or the other. So what something is a case of is the question, what is the broader class that something belongs to? And what something is a case of can change throughout the research. Now, this might be difficult to grasp, so I'm going to try to explain this with an example of how it happened for me when I did my PhD way back, previous century. I was doing a case as part of my fieldwork in the 1990s in a literacy program in a small village. And I chose that case because I was interested in this program and I heard that it was very successful in that particular area. So I sort of started with a case of a single successful development intervention, this literacy program. In reality, throughout the case and even long after, what it was a case of changed. And it changed because of successive insights, the iterative encounters of the case itself, the phenomena, my findings, and how I started to change the way I looked at it. So my conceptual angles also started to change. So it started very innocently. I wanted to study a successful development intervention. The case of the literacy program was a case of a successful development intervention. Then when I was in the village, I realized that it was not standing on itself. This literacy program was part of a network of all type of development interventions, and I had to understand that it was part of the ensemble of development happening there. So then it became a case of development initiative in a village that were informed by history and by other things. And then there was the theory influence. In that time, I read quite a bit about Foucault. So I started to think that this case, that literacy program, because of the language they used around it, I will not go into all the details, but believe me, there were reasons for me to think that I hit on a hegemonic discourse. A hegemonic discourse that imposed a particular type of development on that village, and that the literacy program was part of that particular discourse and exemplary for that hegemonic discourse of modernity that was imposed on this village. So I started to see my literacy program as a case of a hegemonic discourse. Then I was already home, long after my fieldwork, writing up my first draft, talking to colleagues, and then they were criticizing me. And then they said, hey, come on, Thea, this can't be all there was, this hegemonic discourse, and everything fitted very neat into your little box of the hegemonic discourse. There must have been more. So I went back to my notes, I looked it up again, and yes, there was multiplicity. There were more meanings of development, not just modernization, there was also tradition, there were other languages of development in the village. Not that I didn't know or notice, but I never thought it worthwhile to bring it into the analysis until my colleague started to talk with me. I had to go back to my notes, see those different realities. So I ended up with a chapter of a literacy program which was a case of multiple meanings of development. This is how my case evolved, and I really hope the example makes sense to you and that it helps you to understand that you always have to ask yourself not only what is my case, but what is it a case of at the different levels. Now finally, I wanted to raise the point of the wider relevance of case studies. As you may recall, in my first sheet, they would speak about case studies as something that doesn't have broader relevance. It's only about that particular case. We cannot learn more about it from it. I will now try to explain. Of course, we learn a lot from the case itself, but what can a case study offer beyond the immediate relevance for the specific case? And I will bring up three. First, there can be an empirical generalization for a similar situation, similar cases, similar populations. So my study of responses to sexual violence in DRC may be relevant for other areas with high levels of sexual violence, such as South Sudan. Or my study of migrants in Lesbos could be relevant for other migrants in other European countries, hotspots such as Spain or Italy. Or my study of the famine in South Sudan may also be relevant for famines elsewhere in other conflict-affected countries. Now, we have to be very careful with empirical generalization, that you have to try to be rather specific. Don't overgeneralize. So don't say, my study of poor households' coping mechanism strategies in rural country X is relevant for all the household activities, for all the households in the whole universe, because then it doesn't come across as convincing, very unconvincing. Try to be specific how your case could actually have meaningful messages for similar cases. other places, other situations, other people, where more or less similar things are happening. Empirical generalization. There's also sometimes methodological generalization. I tried a new method. I thought it was very specifically relevant for that case. But I can already imagine that this methodology might be relevant for many other cases too. So I really describe the methodology in my paper, and I suggest that this methodology may be used in other places, at other times, with other problems. Methodological generalization. Finally, one case can lead to theoretical generalization. What it means is that you analyze the case and describe it in general concepts. So you use your case to propose theory. Theory, particular concepts that relate to one another in a particular way. And you have derived it from the case, but because you describe it in general concepts, in general theoretical way, you actually invite other researchers to use the same concepts, the same theory, and see whether it works somewhere else, in another case, with another question. They're free to use it, and they can use it because I've written it up in general terms and not specific to my case. So this is what I tried to do in that same PhD that I was talking about, the real world of NGOs. I did my research. It was an ethnography of a single case, one NGO, 23 staff, working in the Philippines. But I use it to develop a theory about NGOs in development and how they work, their discourses, and, the inner working of all those NGOs. And that theory that I developed based on this very single case has now been used by different researchers in other places. Sometimes I read their work, I see they change the theory on the way, they use it their own way, they adapt it, but it is being used because I presented my case in general way, general concept, and I use it to theorize and provide a theoretical generalization. Okay, folks, that's what I wanted to say about case studies. Thank you and keep watching.